Hey guys, welcome to the video. I'm from Salesforce Trainers, and this video or this session would be regarding calling your EPIX classes and their methods from an Lightning component. Okay, so basically you can go to our website again and go to the Salesforce Lightning section and go to the calling EPIX from Lightning component section right here. So, but before even we move on to that, we want to talk about the difference between your JavaScript controller and your Lightning controller in your Aura components. So here we are logged into the developer console of our Aura again. So in order to demonstrate this, let's create a new Lightning component. And let's call this EPIX calling example. So this is our new component right here. So when you create a component, so by default, the only thing created is the component markup, this component tag. So the first step in order to call your EPIX from your Lightning or Aura component is to create a JavaScript or client-side controller for this Lightning component, which you can do by clicking here next to the controller, click on the create, and it'll like populate this by default function for you in your JavaScript controller file. So as you can see, this file is called EPIX calling example controller. So basically our component's name and added a controller next to it, and it is a .js or .javascript file. So this is basically what is our JavaScript controller, right? And what it is used for is if we want to call any JavaScript from a button or anything from our components markup, we need to call it through the JavaScript controller. So let me tell you what we mean by that. So let's say we have this Lightning component, and all that I'm going to do is I'm going to create a Lightning button in here. Lightning colon button, label is my first button. I mean, Lightning button is again a standard Aura component, so you can use it to create buttons in your Aura components. You can give it a label, and then on the click of this button, what we'll do is we'll specify a method. But how do we specify a method? Before even specifying the method, we need to define a method in our JavaScript controller. So when you create a JavaScript controller, this myAction method is like a by default function or method that is created for you. So let's say we are going to use this same function over here. So when somebody presses this button, we want it to call this myAction function. So the way we do that is we copy this name from here, then we go here. Oops, onClick spelling was wrong. And on the onClick, what you do is curly bracket, exclamation mark, then C dot any of my action. And we save it. So this binds the click of this button to this JavaScript function right here. The important thing to keep in mind is you always need to use this C when calling any JavaScript function from your markup. Please do not confuse this C with the dot V that we use for attribute values. Like in the previous example, if we had an attribute here of the name A, we would use V dot to access that attribute. But if we want to access our JavaScript function, we use C. And this is fixed for every Aura component that you create. All right. So we have this function being called, and just to demonstrate that this function is indeed being called, we put in an alert here. Let's say we say function called, we save this. All right. Oops. sorry for that, we save this. And now let's create an application. To preview this, we call this Apex calling example.app. We save this. And just like our previous example, we're gonna just put our thing in here. So what we will do is we'll put our main component in the inside our application. We call it Apex calling example. And we save this up. Now we preview this. So as soon as I preview this, we see this button here. So when I click this button, what should happen is, we should be calling this function right here. And when this function is called, we should be seeing this alert. So let's go back and click this button. So you can see, as soon as I click the button, you are able to see that the alert was caught, right? Now, in the same example, we need to add some more things to be clear about how everything works in our JavaScript controller. So let's say I define an attribute in here. And I again name it my ATT, my attribute. And this is going to be a string type attribute. And the default value for this is gonna be default value or my default. All right. So I think I misspelled attribute. And next to our button, we're gonna print the value of our attribute with using the v dot nomenclature, just as I mentioned. So now we go back here. So as soon as we reload it, you see the my default value is populated here. All right, this one. So now what we want to demonstrate is, let's say we call this JavaScript function right here. So now instead of alerting any value here, we would try and change this attribute's value inside of our JavaScript function. So the way we do that is, so you will see that in your JavaScript function, we have these three things being passed by default. The first is your component, the second is your event, and the third is your helper. We'll talk about the helper in the next video, but for now, what we need to just consider is this component. And we're going to talk about the event in the next sessions as well, when we study events in Lightning components and Aura components, right? So this component, which is being passed into a JavaScript function, this is used to access any attribute value or any function inside of this Aura component. So if you want to fetch this attribute in our JavaScript, we need to use this component, which is being passed. So what we'll do is, obviously inside our JavaScript, we use vars. So let's say we take a var, we call it ATT value, right? And the way we read this attribute's value is, we do component dot get, then we do v dot and the attribute's name, I'm sorry, like this. And we alert out the value. All right, so this component.get will go to your attribute and read out the value of this attribute and fetch the value of this attribute. So by default, the value is my default. So when we alert out this value, we should see that my default value is being alerted out. So I reload this, and as soon as I click this button, you see that this my default value is alerted out right here. So this is how you read the values in your JavaScript controller. Now, let's say we want to change this attribute's value in our JavaScript controller. So the way we do that is, we do component, let me copy this, we do component.set, about the value, the attribute that you want to change, a comma, and then we put the new value that we want to use. So let's say I'm going to use the same var. We are going to do changed value. Then I copy this, I put it here. So when this component dot set runs, this will set this value inside this component. So what will happen is when I click this button, my first button, it'll call our JavaScript function, it'll fetch the value, it'll change the value, then again set the value into our attribute. So this my default, which is being shown here, right, from our markup, this my default should change to this changed value as soon as I click this button, right? So again, we go back, we refresh it. So as soon as I click this, you see that the value was changed to changed value. All right, so this is how you read and you write attribute values in your JavaScript functions. One thing to note here is that these three things, like component, event, and helper, the name which is mentioned here is not fixed. You can use anything that you want. So instead of component, you can use CMP. The only thing to note is that it is always going to be three parameters, and the first one will always refer to the component. So if I use CMP, I can change my component to CMP everywhere we have used it. So now everything will work the same. So it is basically up to you. So again, I click this button, and again, the value gets changed from your JavaScript function. All right. So that is how you change your values in your JavaScript functions. Now, the next thing that you're going to talk about is calling an Apex class and its method from your Aura component. So till now, we have learned about like our JavaScript controller and everything, right? So we're going to keep this in. So now what we're going to do is we're going to attach this component to an Apex class. And that Apex class will act as the server-side controller of this Aura component. Okay, so in order to associate it with the class, we go to new and we create a new Apex class and I call it server side controller. The reason why it is called a server side controller is because now you are moving to your backend into your Apex, which is hosted on the server side, instead of a JavaScript, which is hosted on your client side or on the browser level. Right, so we create this class. Now this is a blank class, but we can still associate it to a type component. We need to copy the name of this class, and in your topmost Aura component tag, you can define controller equals to, and here is where your Apex class name goes. So now this Apex class is bound to this Aura component, and this Apex class will act as the server-side controller for this component. And any method that we define inside this class can be called from an Aura component. So now let's talk about how do we define those methods? Are there any rules to them, and how do we call them? So let's go back to our website, right? So this is where the Aura enabled notation comes into play. So the Aura enabled method, the Aura enabled notation needs to be used with all the methods then we want to call from our lighting or Aura components. So let's say this one is an example. I copy this and I add this as a method inside my Apex class. So you see this Aura enabled notation here, which is set up to this component. So here you see that we have this method. Oops, I think this is not being saved because of some formatting issues, but let me fix that. Okay. So we have this method here called getString, and all this method does is it returns a string value of text, right? And then we have this order-enabled notation added on the top of this method. So now, in order to use this order-enabled method, each Apex method should be static. Only then you are able to use this order-enabled notation. And when you use this order-enabled notation on this method, now we can call this method from a Lightning component. So how do we do that? Now, let's define one more JavaScript function. So you can define as many JavaScript functions as you want. You just need to separate them with a comma. So let's copy the syntax and we call this server calling. We're gonna keep these three same parameters here. Right. Now, inside of this, the way we call our Apex methods goes like this. Let me go back to the side. Yeah. So the way this works is, first, what you need to do is you need to define an action, I mean any variable, val, and then you have to do a component.get. So just as you read attribute values, what you are doing is you're doing component.get. And since now we need to find this method from our Apex class, so let me copy its name and we do action equal to cmp this component.getc.getString. So now this action is bound to this method inside of my class, right? After this, here we have something interesting. We say it is a callback method, right? Let me remove this line so that it doesn't confuse you. So what is a callback method? So basically what happens is when you call any Apex class method from your Aura components, that method is called asynchronously. And what I mean by asynchronously is that JavaScript code does not wait for this method to return the response and it moves on with the execution. So when we need to handle the responses from asynchronous methods, a callback method is the way to implement that. This is a widely used way to handle responses from asynchronous methods. So basically how this works is we define an action and we define a callback for it by setCallback. And inside this callback, we define a function. And so this code inside of this function, this will run when we receive the output back or receive the response back from the Apex class, right? So that's pretty straightforward. Now, inside this method, what we are doing is we are again defining a var called response value. And then we are reading the response return from the Apex class, which in our case would be this test string, by this function called response.getReturnValue. And this response object is a standard object defined in the callback function. So we read this, and then for now, we'll just alert it out. And we alert this var out. Now, lastly, this enqueue action line, this $a.enqueue action, this is what actually calls your method. So we bind our variable to an Apex method, we define the callback, and then finally we call the Apex method by enqueue action. So this enqueues this action on the server. Since it's an asynchronous process, as soon as the server gets all the resources, the method would be called and it would return a response. And then when the response is returned, our callback method will run and just alert out the value. So again, for reference, you can go to our website and check out all the documentation on this. But Now, for example, let me create one more button here. Let me call it calling Apex. And now we want to call this server calling function. And this server calling function will call our backend method. So instead of c.myAction, we do c server calling. Now we go back to our example. And so when I click this calling Apex button, you see it took a second because it was asynchronous, but after that it returned the test response. If I call this again, it again gets the test response again and again. If I go to my Apex class and let's say I change the method to return Salesforce thrillers, I save it again and refresh it and I click Apex. Now it returns to me Salesforce thrillers. And here is from where it is alerting me this value right here inside the callback method. So this is like the basic way to call your Apex methods from your other components. So that is it for this video, guys. And see you guys in the next video where we will build out a form and save a account record to our backend database by calling an Apex method. So see you guys in the next video.